James and Andy are feared all over the world. Whenever I say I'm going on a global underground tour, and they say, are James and Andy coming with you? It's okay. Okay. In fact, they're very nice people to work for. They bring new meaning to the word party animal. They are, you know, they are like endless, non-stop. You really should just run, run.
James is my best friend. He is a prophet. Global underground and our DJs like a prophet in Hungary.
They're seen very much so as a benchmark as to what a cool CD should be. Some of the guys they've got on the roster, you know, Dave Seaman, Nick Warren, Sasha, Digweed, there's, you know, really are some amazing DJs. They do have some of the best talent in the world.
It's a double act, and one does all the business side of their company, and the other person's, I suppose, more creative.
It's almost like you get past the clowning around, and you actually see that there's two very, very sussed out, quite smart business guys behind all that.
It's a world stage for some of the DJs to do kind of what they really do, and it's taken everything away from, I think, what everyone calls crap mix 2000 CDs. They've been very clever because their CDs are worldwide. It's not just like another UK compilation.
Global Underground is basically our attempt to capture just the global nature of dance music. It's a DJ mix series that takes DJs...
Go on holiday.
No, not on holiday. So it's the DJ mix series that takes DJs all over the world.
Yeah, I mean, when we first started out, we're selling, like, I don't know, we'd be lucky to sell 10 or 20,000 copies of an album, but things have moved on so much in the last 3 or 4 years that, for instance, say, Paul Oakenfold New York albums, it's sold in excess of 150,000 worldwide. Sasha Ibiza's Hot on His Heels with 120-odd.
A bit of money, not a huge amount of money. We're not millionaires or anything. I mean, me and Andy always classify ourselves as the only millionaires who haven't got £1 million in the bank, you know what I mean? It's like, but...
Haven't you?
All right, you have.
Well, just the two, like.
Buenos Aires, surprising.
It's just stuff from the UK, so just about for the Sasha album, the track listing, so. Which is interesting, me.
I don't mind if that's for the world. If they're going to clear that track for £5,000 for the world, it's not a problem, but in paying that for the UK, it's a piss take.
Because we travel so much, we're always dotting around all over the place. I mean, we've always got a laptop with us to pick emails and artwork and stuff like that. Just get used to being on the road and running the business that way.
We've got a good bunch of lads, that's important.
We're in Buenos Aires.
We're here to do the next Global Underground album with DJ Dave Seaman. Got in late last night, went out, had a meal, got really
got
drunk.
Got in very late this morning.
Late this morning, suffering horrendous hangovers. But
Martin, the promoter's gone missing.
Yep. But we're in South America and it beats Newcastle any day of the week. The women are
very intelligent.
Very intelligent, wonderful personalities. Can't understand a word they say.
Which
but
is probably good.
They look great anyway, so that's good.
Which is more than you do.
The food's meat, more meat, which is absolutely fantastic. But unfortunately, I'm a vegetarian. So far, the salads have been salads, I suppose. Yeah, it's very European, Buenos Aires.
Yeah, very, very European. A lot less South American than I
probably
thought.
Probably see, it looks a bit like Madrid.
We're going to go in here for a bevy, if you want to follow us.
If you want to join us, you can. But then again, you're probably not paid, so see you later, lad.
Pretty embarrassing, really, isn't it? The British people just are particularly lazy with languages and stuff like that, really.
Having said that, we always get by, don't you?
Yeah.
Bevy means bevy in any language, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I love that thing of, like, you know, it's, the music's great, it's great going party, but it's just, you just meet the most crazy people, and you just have for this one moment in time, which is, like, in essence of, like, you know, you're never going to meet them again. You're never going to see them again. But for, like, you've got a brand new best friend for the evening, and it's like you're there and you have a good laugh at night. That's what it's all about.
Got shown around by Christian and this Brazilian guy called Enrique. Went to the main square where they have all these monuments and stuff to a lot of the atrocities that went on in the past.
We're in Plaza de Mayo, okay? Yeah. That's the main square of the city.
Yeah.
And here is the symbol of the Madres de Plaza de Mayo. This is a group of mothers that lost their sons during the government, the military government here in the 70s. Okay.
All right, yeah.
This is the symbol.
It's like a scarf.
The scarf, yes. And there you can see this, The lost people is painted in the floor.
Really?
That's the meaning of this drawing.
Is that why they're a silhouette?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's a lot.
So how many people were lost then?
I don't know exactly, but it's around 30,000 people. It's a lot of
people. Especially quite poignant with the thing that's going on with Pinochet in the UK at the minute. The youth of Argentina for I don't know how many years it was, just disappeared. I suppose probably fundamentally people like us, if we'd been Argentinian, probably wouldn't have been here.
You know, at that time, the thing is that we don't know almost anything of what was happening. You know, everything was hidden. The war was 1982, but the war was really a mistake in all terms. So the memories, you know, it's tough to think in that time because it's dark and sad.
Bearing in mind all the hassles that obviously went on with the Malvinas, with, you know, with the Falkland Islands, you know, you didn't know exactly how the British were going to be accepted in Argentina.
In terms of Argentina, perception of a British, I can give you an example. You probably are going to see on in the crowd people dancing, and don't get surprised if you find a British flag.
We always make an effort to try and see different parts of the city away from dance music, you know what I mean? So we went to the Boca. This is obviously the home of, like, Maradona, and it's on the docks. It's a slum area, which shows slight signs of a tourist rejuvenation in the very centre, but still around the outskirts, it's hardcore, you know what I mean?
The photography, and we pulled up, and these kids playing football on this basically bit of waste ground, you know. So Dean dives out, does his usual, not a problem, dives
well,
out.
That's not absolutely true. What happened was we're in the back of this van, and I'm saying to Dean, stay in the van. No, it's all right, I'll go out.
They're all right, honestly.
So Dean gets out of the van, and they'd all stopped playing football while Dean was taking photographs because apparently Dean thought they liked him. When in fact they were all mustering themselves up to steal all his camera equipment.
Let's mug the tourists.
Yeah, apparently the translation was, yeah, let's mug the students and kick the shit out of them.
It was all right.
No one's got killed, but okay.
Dave's a very, very musical DJ. All his records are, you know, they're all in key, and all his sets are programmed.
They want to know what they do different from the DJ from here. They want to see Dave Seaman.
The place is just a total melting pot. It's just crazy.
There's a guy called David Lorimer who used to run the Pink Gin Mobile Discotheque in Leeds. And I just thought, fantastic, he's getting paid lots of money to play his favourite records and he's getting loads of girls as well. What a job.
Maybe the best DJ in the world. Better than the rest. He's the only one.
The only one.
This is nothing. You're the worst.
Half past 8 in the morning. We're totally doolally.
Doolally.
We're having a bit of a poo-na-na, a bit of a rah-rah-rah. And we're feeling pretty
spunky. Spunky.
Yeah, spunky.
That's
done. Spunky's done good.
Spunky did good. Left a bit of a stain on the dance floor, but he done good.
And what's your name?
Magma.
I've personally heard, and I don't really condone it. In fact, it makes my stomach turn. It's sex, drugs, rock and roll, and a bit of like lewd behaviour.
Every time I get drunk. I learned to break dance when I was about 14. Took my lino down to shopping arcades in Leeds. But I did it for like 10 years or something, and then one silly drunken night, I decided that I could do a windmill stunt. Flash. Oh. Whoa. Whoa. I'm about halfway way around the world and get that kind of reaction is brilliant. Get two girls and fold in the Union Jack. I was in the olive branch out. You see things on the news back in England about, you know, when Prince Charles came here and they were burning British flags and stuff. Well, it doesn't happen in dance music. They get the flag out and wave it for you. Yeah, it's been a mad week. Last Friday, I played in St. Louis, Missouri, Jacksonville, Florida on Saturday. Sunday, flew back to England. I went straight into the studio Monday and Tuesday to work on a remix for Placebo and David Bowie, and then got on a plane back on Wednesday. Went to Miami and then on to Tampa, played in Tampa on Wednesday night. Thursday, Birmingham, Alabama. Friday, played in Miami at Groove Jet, and played here on Saturday night. And partied all the way through till last night, and here we are, fresh as a daisy.
What Dave's been really, really clever at is basically taking what he knows about dance music, adding it to major label artists and giving them, you know, oodles of credibility.
Janet Jackson and Michael Jackson and David Bowie and New Order and Seal and the Brand New Heavies. I never thought, you know, 20 years ago when I started DJing, I was getting £2.50 at the youth club, that I'd be in a swimming pool in Buenos Aires getting paid lots of money to fly around the world and do it. Halfway around the world to Buenos Aires, Argentina, and it might as well be Manchester. Thank God for indoor pools.
We're not in! This team is the doors. Hello, it's me. Why is no one answering this phone? I'm working hard here.
Ibiza wouldn't have been our first choice to do an album with, but Sasha was playing a residency last summer at a club called Space, which is probably the best club in the world.
It was almost a little bit of a challenge, really, to see if we could pull something off from Ibiza. It seems it now being a bit of a cheesy haven for like 18 to 30s, and it's been proved that this club at Space is the best club on the island, if not the best club in the world. And there is still an underground dance scene there, and that's obviously what we were there for.
It's James. Why is no one in the office, mate? All right, yeah, good answer. Hey, Tom, it's Saturday, isn't it? All right, just as well I wasn't going to kick off with you then, innit?
Sasha within the dance music industry is a legend. In the same way that George Best was the first superstar footballer, Sasha was the first superstar DJ. There was no adulation, no hero worship before Sasha. DJs were DJs, they just played records. It wasn't like considered an art form. It wasn't even considered musical. It was just considered what you needed. You really need someone to do that. The same way you'd need someone to serve drinks. Yeah. And Sasha changed all that. The way that you can play a record is as important, if not more important, than the record you're actually playing.
Charles Bukowski is keeping me company on the road at the moment. He's like this low-life writer and full-time alcoholic and poet and Casanova. And I think as a role model, he's terrible, but he absolutely cracks me up. So he's been keeping me company. This is Steph. She's my PR agent from New York. I've just flown over because I've been talking about Ibiza for like 3 years since I met Stephanie. So I thought the opening of Space would be a good time to bring Steph out and give her a taste of it. This is where Pepe has let me stay for the week.
In between five, he's one of the best of the world.
Pepe is the owner of Space. He's very generously let me stay in his pad for the week, which is fantastic, really. I think they've just finished it, and it's absolutely, I mean, as you can see, stunning. Nicest place I've ever stayed at in Ibiza.
When I see him playing, it seems that he's connected to the turntables through the people, flowing the energy to them, in contact with the people and without losing 1 second of energy contact together, people and him together. He's there, block.
Sasha was a guy, a spotty teenager, living in Manchester, and he had this thrust upon him. And this is the days before management teams, PR companies, marketing companies, record companies, in fact. First time he ever signed an autograph was in Middlesbrough. And he thought someone was taking the piss out of him.
Finished the DJ set at Mambo. I tried to do
my Ibiza vibe. It was a bit difficult though, because when I came out to Ibiza, I thought I'd be just playing in space, so I bought the most banging records in my collection. So I tried to pull out a few things with guitars and seemed to work all right. It would be very easy for me to get on the decks and play a load of huge records that people knew to get a reaction out of a crowd. The buzz that I kind of get out of it and the kind of thing that keeps driving me is about layering sounds and building energy up in the music. And once you've actually got to the point where you've got this energy built up in the club, you can pretty much play a brand new record that was just finished yesterday that no one's ever heard before, and they'll go crazy for it if it's a good record. I spent my whole life travelling. Australia, Singapore, Hong Kong, the most remote places on earth. As soon as you mention your name at Virgin Atlantic, it's like you get upgraded. You're first in line for a massage when you get on the plane. In general, when you walk down the street, it's not like you've got some reporters in your bins and you've got any kind of the trappings and the horribleness that goes with having that rock star lifestyle. And I'd hate that. I'd hate to have my personal life sort of, you know, printed in the magazines every week and or in the newspapers. But, you know, it seems like I have all the good bits out of that kind of lifestyle without actually having to deal with all the horrible bits. It's like, it's brilliant.
The amount of lunatics that come up to him asking him to do whatever. I mean, it would drive you insane. But he's got a wall, his wonder wall or whatever you want to call it. He's got a barrier between him. He's very much polite, the consummate professional nowadays.
Sasha was invited to play at the mayor of San Antonio's private party.
Which sounded good at the time.
Which sounded good at the time. However, on arrival at the venue,
which is a new club called Eden. Mm-hmm. Which we thought sounded quite swanky this night. We came round the corner only to discover it's a famous star club. The star club was legendary from the late 80s, early 90s for being denim and equity intact. The club 80-30 sort of clientele.
Yeah.
And Sasha's avoided like a plague for years and years and years.
He got offered £10,000 at the beginning of the beginning year to play here, and he's ended up playing there for nothing. The Star Club, which actually Sasha described as the athlete's foot on Ibiza's club life.
Here he is, the peak of his career, remix Madonna, Chemical Brothers, blah blah, flies in Ibiza to play at the Star Club. Oh,
let's just say that one more.
The Star Club.
Traditionally, the opening parties and the closing parties are very special days. So when you couple that with space and the albums and all the other things that were going on, like the film crew and stuff like that, it just created this cocktail of excitement.
Germans, you get Swiss, you get Austrians. A lot of Italians go there. There was Brazilians, people from Uruguay, Chile, Peru. You've got North Americans, people from Canada there. It's just a real cosmopolitan attitude, which is totally sums up what we're all about. It's almost like Twin Peaks, you know? There's a real David Lynch sort of aspect to it. You're thinking, what the hell is going on here? I mean, who for Christ's sake builds a terrace to a nightclub? You'd still call it a nightclub, but it's not open on a night. The outside, the terrace is bright, and the inside is a cavernous hole.
collected a whole host of different people from all over the world and did vox pops with them. Asked them why were there, why space was so special. They included this all in a booklet with photographs of them and did photo sessions on the roof and put it all together in this limited edition booklet. And it was our attempt to actually, a snapshot in time, to capture that and just reflect the sort of people that were there.
If there could be one club in the world that sums up the global underground ethos, that club would be it.
I'm Bale, I'm the tour manager of Global Underground. I didn't know that the title tour manager includes everything. The reason being in Berlin because, as we all know, it's love-created. We think we should be part of festivals such as Love Parades. You have to put in an application in February. Each year, each country can have only one drop. It's gonna be a tricky one, though. 2.5 tons worth of energy.
We just arrived via London, via Ibiza. I'm going to be celebrating with over a million people the Love Parade for the first time ever. This turntable here is the turntable that I travel with. I take it with me all over the world. It's quite light, and I purchased it in Tokyo. It's probably equivalent of about 100 pounds. And it has such silly features as it even has pitch control, which is quite useful for me. The less is better theory. I don't overuse it. It just depends on the song, the crowd, where I am, and you know, the vibes that I'm going with. an Andy of Global Underground. I love their attitude. I love their openness to the music. It is like, you do your thing.
Complete fucking disaster as usual. Typical Global Underground bollocks.
Complete disaster.
Complete disaster. No, it's amazing.
Yeah. No, I'm not homesick. I'm homesick for Hungary.
The first time we went to Budapest, we went with Nick Warren to do his third album for us, and we didn't know what to expect. Because Nick had played there about a year before, and he said, you know, next album I've got to do it in Budapest.
And I've never seen Nick as animated. Can't believe this club, it's just, well, what, yeah, do you know what I mean? I haven't got a clue what you're talking about, Nick. It really reaffirmed a certain belief in us, in what we originally started off doing. So you wanted to do the album here, and we turned up.
Time to call this. Working on Hungarian time already. This is our favourite checking clerk.
Where are we from?
It's Gabby, Terminal 2, Heathrow. The world's worst terminal.
And we're on our way to Hungary.
Budapest.
To our club, which we do with Bila over there. It's going to be the first night of our new series, New Breed, Anthony Pappa. So the small boy from Australia is going over to the big city in Hungary. And let's see how he does.
First time we went to Hungary was about a year ago with Nick Warren to do his Budapest album. We had such a wicked weekend, such a crazy weekend. Parties non-stop. Been going back there once a month to run a club with Bela, who now works for us, doing all the international tours and coordination. So, a bit of a weird one really, but it works.
Andy Pappa's secret, dead sea crystal.
What was the gig like?
Excellent. Israel, Tel Aviv. Really, really good last night. Really good.
One of my best mates from Newcastle really hasn't been out of Newcastle for a long time, and he's been so excited about coming to Hungary. I think he's going to burst this week, so it's going to be interesting to see how Hodgie, latterly known as the Turbine, the breakdancer from hell, how he's going to take to the Hungarian nightlife.
So what are you going to do with them?
Use every one of them.
Right, Jim, that's the weekend of serious
debauchery. Absolutely.
Between 2 to 5 hours, we'd be at Geta.
First impressions of Bela? I don't know, he's really sort of amiable guy.
I think we both liked him because he was fatter than us. So when we stand next to him, look at this.
How slim we look.
Look, you're holding it in again, aren't you? I don't think Andy and myself, I really envisaged even Bela moving to potentially Newcastle.
No.
I mean, I think at first we just thought Bela could work here, because most of the gigs we're doing now are around Europe anyway. But I mean, when Bela said he wanted to move there, that was even better, because I mean, the big thing about our office is, as no doubt you're going to find out, it's a bunch of idiots, really.
He's an adopted Geordie now. I mean, very similar sense of humour to us, very dry.
So he's half Geordie and we're half Hungarian, apparently.
Don't know which half exactly.
Look at us, those screws the last time.
This is our friend Argos.
Yeah, it's a good friend. It's a very good one.
It's a proper communist sort of pub bar restaurant, and it's a piece thick, because there's so many little details which was dead important, and the red telephone there is one of the most important things. Is that my dad had one of the red telephones at his office as well. The red telephone was the symbol of the communist leaders, because they had all these red telephones in between them. So if your boss wanted to speak to you, he just picked up the red telephone, and that's automatically rung in your room. This is Christina, my wife.
when both of them came over, it was just so different to anybody else that had been over. They were totally different. It's quite interesting to be the only woman and to be respected as well. And they do treat me differently. I mean, I have been told that, you know, I'm a girl with bollocks. Originally, I'm from Southeast London, and the reason I got to Hungary was because of Baylor.
I asked the Danny Tenaglia party.
Well, I think if it's that sort of thing, then you just get a local photographer to do it. Rather than fly Dino, it's going to cost a fucking fortune.
But do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah, I get what you're saying.
Do you think it's a good idea?
I think it's okay, yeah.
Could you come up with a better idea?
I haven't thought about it.
Well, I have.
I'm going to be playing for about 7 hours because there wasn't a DJ, but apparently the DJ hasn't turned up, so the whole night's up to me now. I'm going to kind of take it easy over 7 hours and build it slow and funky, build it up to more progressive kind of bit techie kind of trance, and then, you know, some techno, some breakbeats thrown in. It's just going to be like a big soundscape over 6 hours. When you've got a crowd where they're just so positive and so into what you're doing, it touches you inside, and you kind of take that into the way you choose your records, and you kind of connect.
Call me always?
Yes, yeah. Always. Okay. Always the best.
Anthony Pappa?
Like,
what do you think?
People.
Very good.
Very good people.
How good?
Very nice people.
Yeah. Pitchy and or?
Not young. Not young. Very, 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 very,
very, very good.
Yeah.
Pop, mainly pop, making records for more than 8 years. I did several gigs here before it became this kind of club. It's much more unique.
At the end of the day, the guy's there to work, and one person coming up annoying the fuck out of a DJ could spoil the enjoyment for the other 1,000 people in the club. On that sort of level, you've got to be careful and you've got to be quite tactful about things.
They don't know all the songs, they don't know the performers, they don't know anything about the songs, just they feel the pumping, they feel the groove, they want to have fun. That's all.
Gunther is not Yugoslavia.
Yeah, but no, hold on, it's not Yugoslavia.
Serbia. You're from Serbia. Yeah.
And I'm a gypsy.
Yeah, liquid design, Christina.
Every month we make a party like this. With English people, English DJs. There, here's James from Global Underground. The situation is shit now, but the people is okay, you know. You can not see so many grizzlies like here, you know.
Grizzly, you know? And the gangster.
They have a skinhead.
This is my brand new best friend. What's your name again?
Hi.
T-shirt, what is it? Body T-shirt, you know.
My other brand new best friend, Leslie.
Yes.
I play the music and excellent VIP and harem size ambulance. What do you have?
300
people in a crazy dancing. My style is a breakbeat and a hard drums and electro and a new age, old school, new school, trip hop, drum and bass. Yeah. Anthony Pappa in rushing time is everybody in high. There's people in faces. Yeah, crazy. And a VIP room and a small feeling. It's an easy drum, it's a grooving. Yeah. And yeah, and small.
Ooh, sexy.
Yeah, sexy. Yeah. Every people is sexy, yeah.
Sexy.
Welcome to the Hungary, man, yeah.
I'd be quite happy for a good 20 years, maybe. Just keep it going.
Because I haven't seen one unfit bird in there,
yep.
Mate.
They all working us.
And you as a punter, what do you reckon?
I'm not a punter. No, it's absolutely badass.
Oh, your little brother.
Little brother, I understand the picture.
Yeah, I do. Come on.
Really good gig. Probably the best one I've had so far. Played for about 6.5 hours. Crowd were wicked. I moved to England because the dance scene in England is just the best in the world for me. To make it as a DJ, I felt that's where I needed to be. It was a challenge as well. I kind of outgrew Australia a little bit. We're back in Budapest now, checking into another hotel, and I'm not sure how long I'm going to be here for, but I've got to get to Helsinki tonight.
I mean, I'll party hard, as you know, but James will be the last man standing. He will be the man going, come on, we'll get another bottle of whiskey, and after he'd been up for 2 days or something ridiculous. Last night, I mean, he's lost, he's drunk God knows how much whiskey and whatever. And at times like that, I'll look out for him, and I'll be in a similar state the week after, and he'll look after me. He's always the idiot that'll be at the party longer than I will. When you met him once, you certainly won't forget you met him. Too many people panned at the DJs. All the guys we work with are totally cool. They're really nice guys, they're relaxed, they're sat and the other. But, I mean, they're surrounded by sycophants 24 hours a day. In blue, two fat Geordie lads and tell them they're a set of twats. DJs are very important, they're the tastemakers of the whole scene, and James and I would not be where we are now without them, but they're human beings. So let's not put them on a pedestal.
I had a relationship for like 3.5 years, and it just came to a head of the travelling and stuff like that. It's just not fair on the girl. And like ever since then, it's just been a succession of, I don't know, one night stands or whatever you want to call it. And it is very, very difficult. The fact that we've got such close friends, and when we are in Newcastle, we go out with our mates. And there's not that many people, A, I would inflict it on, or B, would put up with the way we go on. I mean, who needs a boyfriend you're going to see once a month? It's just like, it's a joke, you know what I mean?
This has been the bane and the end of every relationship I've ever had. Because basically, and I don't get me wrong, we have all in the past probably been Mr. Untrustworthy, double-dealing, backstabbing, untrustworthy, whatever. And like every girlfriend I've ever had says the same thing. Wait a minute, you must think I'm stupid. The lad in the back of this car, what?
Oh my God!
Pretty cool, huh?
One day I'll find, or James will find somebody that's happy to put up, not put up with, but accept the way we are. That, you know, half the week when we're back, we're going to want to go out with our mates. We're not going to want to spend 5 nights a week with said girlfriend. But there's girls like that very few and far between. And, I mean, I don't think James or myself have ever found somebody that's prepared to accept that.
Where are we? We're on the way to the bath, Gellert Bath, which is famous thermal baths in Budapest. I've been here like 6 or 7 times, and I've always meant to come, you know. And at last I come with a terrible hangover. It's supposed to be a really good cure for hangover.
Nice to get out and about and see people and do different things and do sort of touristy stuff. So a lot of the places we go to, we probably never get a chance to go back for 2 or 3 years or something like that. So it's nice to be able to come and do stuff like this. I like spending money, yeah, of course I like spending money, you know. Infinitely better than saving it, you know. It's what you're here for, isn't it, to go out and enjoy yourself. Yeah, fucking I got in there and then fucking got woken up. Ended up going to the office, come back here.
Why go to the office?
Just went to the office, like, fucking mad, didn't it?
Thanks for ringing us then.
Well, I did. Thanks for that.
See you later, Andy.
Anthony, how was Helsinki tonight?
Amazing, really good gig. Yeah. Really, it was cold, actually.
Yes.
he's asking us.
What's the weather like?
Boiling up. You don't want to take much stuff, honestly. Shorts and T-shirts. Really? Bearing in mind, you just come from Tel Aviv.
So he took a T-shirt with him?
T-shirt with him.
-10 degrees.
I left the club about 4 times.
And then me and this young lady were going to go back and have some drinks and stuff. And I couldn't find a taxi. So anyway, who do you know comes out the hotel? The two blokes with the bald head. So they get in the back of the cab. I go, hey, hey, go on, let's go, take me to the hotel. So we're in the car for 10 minutes. And then they turn around and went, which hotel? And I didn't know the fucking name of it. So turn around all the way back to the club. News to say, the girl got away.
It's got free.
But don't worry, I could still find the blokes with the bald heads.
This is Cabbage, who's from Hungary.
Sort of feeling a little bit.
And usually is.
I'm going with Seth Fontaine to San Francisco this Monday and then go to Mexico City. Soon after that, we're going to go to South Africa.
This is Blinky.
Hello.
Who's blind?
I deal with royalty accounting, ordering CDs, and also do a few bits and bobs of DJing, and also anything that those two want us to do.
This is John. He's special. Or he used to be special, so he told everyone.
I basically look after the website side of things for the company and anything else that James and Andy want us to do.
Yeah, miscellaneous.
Miscellaneous.
Valued member of staff nevertheless. John Paul's been sacked somewhere in the region of about 500 times for no particular reason.
I deal with the sales of the albums and press now and then and collecting money off people.
John Paul worries a lot.
Yeah.
And panics. He's a panic merchant. But he's very, very good at his job.
And it's per everyone else, just anything else Andy and James want me to do, basically, during the day. Just buy their food, buy their clothes, make sure their clothes are clean, do anything for them they like. And we all enjoy doing it as well, mate.
Of course, that's a good answer. This is our map of world domination. And this is everywhere we've been in the last 3 years. Or 4 years. Furthest away, New Zealand, which we did New Year. Australia, South America, Thailand. We do a lot of stuff in Hong Kong, which Vila sorts out. Where are we going? Toronto, Bali, which is very, very nice indeed. Japan, which Seb Fontaine's going to be going doing a tour over there. Philippines, which is just good for Miami, LA, San Francisco. Funnily enough, to be honest, we've probably been to places like this more, an American mall, than we have actually been to Europe. But that's just sort of really the way it is. I mean, most of the times when we go away, we tend to go somewhere to do business.
It is good working with them. It's a nice, relaxed atmosphere.
Awful, terrible. Absolutely, no, it's really, really good. They're excellent people to work for. And I just got a bonus for saying that.
So, it's always a good laugh.
Hiya!
You just have to know them to know it'll be crazy. Simple as that, really.
What's that, mate? What are you looking at?
It's me home videos from Uruguay, mate. Just want a fatty making a fucking idiot of him, Dan. No. Look at that fucking idiot there.
Hiya.
I've been asking Darren Emerson to work with us for 10 years.
Emeroid, yeah.
Well, that was a really strange thing, going out with somebody that answers to the name Emeroid.
Uruguay was weird, for those who don't know. It's the next country. It's above
below.
Argentina.
Below.
No, it's above.
It's below.
It's above.
It's below.
James, it's above Argentina, you prat.
What?
It's between Argentina Uruguay and Brazil.
Don't feel me, right?
So anyway, Uruguay was a bit weird, because obviously we've been
I'm going to check up on this.
Sponsorship meeting tomorrow about a sponsorship deal for next year. We've got a meeting with Home
tomorrow night. We've got Bedrock on Thursday night. A couple of our artists are flying in from Holland to do that, Packer and Frederick. We've
got Fabric on Friday night. We've got all those other stuff that I've forgotten because I haven't got my diary in front of me, but yeah, we've got a pretty busy week. We're down for 4 or 5 days.
Where are we going?
We are going to Funky Camden, mates.
Yeah, it's a photo shoot for Crossfade magazine, which we're doing with Darren Emerson.
We're going to do that through about 4 o'clock then, yep. And we've got Israeli TV. Crossfade is like a DJ-based magazine. So it's going to come out sort of late March, which is going to be about 3 weeks before release. It's a cover, which is always good, so it's going to be on, you know, newsstands all over the place, and it's good. It's the first cover we've ever done, so no doubt it'll be the last one as well, but...
Yeah, I think it's a really important sort of time for Darren. I think, although he's obviously very excited about it, he also feels, I think he's feeling a little bit of pressure. But it only probably bit he's putting on himself because he feels so excited about the project. As much as you try and hype them up to do it and trying to keep them excited about it, it's really important that you don't let the DJ paranoia set in and that they start thinking about things too much and that they just let, like, when they're in the club, they just play records that flow.
They're a pain in the arse, these mixes, actually. They're hard work. It sounds really easy. You're going to do it. Yeah, no problem. And then you start getting into it, go a bit deeper, then you start getting all these records, and you like that one, you like this one. By the end of it, you've got so many, you've got to sort of try and wangle it down a little bit.
I really like DJing when you're touring around, you know, when you're sort of your own boss. But then again, if I weren't doing Underworld, I'd really miss that. With Underworld, it was very sort of DJ mixed two musicians.
Yeah.
You know, and I didn't really know much, but I wanted to learn, of course, you know, because you get to a stage where you're DJing and you feel like you can mix really well, you know how to do all that. Mm. And you're being quite successful, you know, you're doing quite well, you're working up the ladder. And the next thing you do want to do is sort of start producing.
It's all gone cooked before.
Yeah, we're getting on the case, right? But before the bike sets off, ring me because we might have moved. But I think an hour should
That's
be
no all... way to talk about your girlfriend.
Right? See you, Andy, that's below the belt, which is more than you've got, anything below the belt.
Yeah,
like being on the Titanic, being in business with us, once it's set off, that's you fucked.
You're going down whether you like it or not.
This one bit I don't like about it is the travelling. Because it's tiring. It's just sitting about all day, doing nothing, watching TV and that. You start getting really fat. Because you're drinking beer and loads
What's the matter
with that? Here he goes
then. Again.
I'll keep doing that.
What's that word?
Fuck me, that's an Arafat.
Yeah. What do you mean Arafat?
I want to get a Mac, they're a lot better.
Want to get a Mac, do
I? Don't believe any of this clown rubbish. They're really very smart.
God, your ass stinks.
Yeah, so does his mixing, mate. I'll leave you, babe.
Alright, lads. Welcome to my place in Romford. This is where we're going to be doing the Globe Underground mix. Not Uruguay, but you know, I'm sure it'll be cool.
Basically, the sampler will take a chunk of the record, which will repeat it.
I'll get a record.
This is the track I was just playing you. What I'm going to do now, I can go on this one. Now I can press this. Something like that.
I'm Paul. Cheeky Paul, sometimes. I'm in the studio, this is where I work. We're going to record Darren, but Darren's been very busy all day doing interviews and stuff, so we're still waiting to start.
Some of the ideas I've put down, you know, have gave me ideas to sort of do what we're doing now. I'm trying to find records that are sort of doing the same sort of thing. Like the last one I was using, and now this one has got the same sort of bass line, so it's going to sort of gel really well. Won't take as long at all, he says, in front of the camera. Now I'm here, I'm getting other ideas now, so it's opening a can of worms up, really. We've just come out of the car, and now we're going into the embassy rooms, which is in Islington.
Which is a licensed vitriolous. Place of worship, and we're going to go in
the Cockney Central.
Come on. And we're going to go in there and, have a beverage. We do okay, you know, financially and this, that, and the other. My mum still says to me, you know, I caught her the other day, she's so like, things are good out here, when are you going to get a proper job?
My name is Adisha Bat from the first DJ magazine in Israel. Just interviewed the guys from the box, and it was very nice, because in Israel, everybody listens to the Global Underground series.
My mum comes out to watch Underworld.
Did she?
I'll get away.
Oh, yeah, a few times. My mum and dad are like that on the side of the stage.
The DJs in Israel are trying to be much alike and try and using the sounds from the global series, which is really very nice. And having global parties in R&B 58 in Tel Aviv is a real huge, massive party.
First time I met him, I just couldn't believe that two people like them could achieve what they've done and how they did it.
When I was going out with this girl, it would always end up the situation of like arguing because it's like, I've got to go to work tonight. And he's like, well, what? You mean like going out and drinking and listening to music and talking to people is work? I'm like, yeah. And he's like, but that's the truth. I mean, obviously there's other things that go on it as well, but it's a very strange sort of like twilight zone that everybody works in.
I've heard some stories about them, but I guess now it's not the time.
People quite often ask why we still live in Newcastle, especially as we've had to spend more time in London.
Travelling all over, you know, you go to New York or you go to Tokyo or whatever, and people are amazed at the fact they actually come back to Newcastle to live. To be quite honest, the two reasons for me that we come back to Newcastle is A, because of our friends.
And B, I'm your boss.
And B, you're sacked and you're not getting paid this week. And B, really, it's because Newcastle's an absolutely amazing place to live. I mean, if you take this place, like Malmaison, it's probably one of the best hotels I've ever stayed in. And it's on me, it's next door to my house.
Any culture that's had something really hard has still got this passion within itself to do something else. And I think that's part of human nature, that when it gets so bad, you just got to laugh.
Yeah, our first album was with Tony DeVee. A really sort of important album for us, because it took all our, every single penny we had into that album. And it was like, it was make or break for us, really. And Tony, God rest him, was like, I don't think he really understood how big a DJ he was.
I don't think he did. Certainly didn't then. I mean, just before his death, he was definitely the biggest DJ in Britain. He was right on the verge.
And he was the one who came up with the Tel Aviv thing. You know, and then in the press, you know, people were saying, who the hell are Global Underground, who are Box, who are Global Underground, all that sort of stuff. And people were asking, you know, well, Tel Aviv, what's the connection? What's all that about? And to be honest, that was exactly the reaction we wanted. People think that bulletproof, you know what I mean? Everyone's got this attitude. And I think that because people going out and they're so hedonistic, which is brilliant, you know, that's great. And they're going out, like having a good time, and I think it really puts morality, not morality, but your mortality into some sort of like
perspective, really. Yeah. I mean, the fragility of the, you know, the human race, really, like James says. Yeah.
You just
think you're immortal, but you're not.
Me and Andy have been through everything. And I know that, like, I mean, like, we started off with £5, which we bought some dodgy cassettes. I mean, he's Vauxhall Astra. And, like, we've been through it all. And I know that, like, when I get up in the morning, no matter what happens, I can trust him. Andy's strength is his strength. His willpower. He's a number-crunching exocet missile. I really appreciate how lucky I am to do what I do, but I also realise how lucky I am to have a best mate like him. And he is very good at what he does, but don't say I said that. And that's basically what, you know, he's very good at organisational skills. He's brilliant at, like, basically, he can't leave anything alone. He's got his sticky. Bleedy. He's got porky trotters. Have you seen his hands? Don't look at his hands, but don't say anything. You seen his hands like pig's feet, aren't they? Oh, his feet, don't even mention his feet. He's got toenails like chisels, and he's got the loudest nostrils in Western Europe. When he blows his nose. But that's basically it. I mean, he's brilliant what he does. But like I said, don't say I said that. I really don't know if there's a price to it. I can't see one. But the thing is, I don't want to be flippant or arrogant about it. We're having a right laugh. But it's part of British culture that you're almost to feel embarrassed about enjoying yourself. It's that Victorian value, isn't it? Of feeling guilty about having a good time or being very lucky or winning the lottery or having money in your pocket. You know, it's one of them things. But at the end of the day, we're having a right laugh. I can't answer that question. You answer it for me.
Couple of years ago, somebody pulled me in a club just after we got Sasha to do the first album. He came up, industry board, you know, head of major record company, said, "You guys aren't as stupid as you look." And then we just turned around and went, "Yes, we are."
How old are you?
Can
pop it out.
I'm paying for it.
I'm the Prince of Darkness. Needs to meet.
Booyah!
Two management day and night.
And every week, ding, 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 ding.
AKA the Predator.
I'm not having this shit.
I can't believe you said that.
Thank you. Good night.